A colleague and a friend of mine, the national writer of the Philippines, NVM Gonzalez, he had a number of years ago wrote an essay called Even as the Mountain Speaks. And in that he was talking about Mount Pinatubo and the kind of volcanic eruption which kind of covered Clark Air Force Base, right? And so he was talking about Even as the Mountain Speaks in terms of colonization and in terms of the what you do to counter colonization, and the creative process is really a large part of it. And that's what Angel's going to be talking about today, the creative process from the viewpoint and experience of a Filipino-American woman. Angel Velasco Shaw is a filmmaker, writer, cultural critic, activist, curator, educator, a Renaissance woman. Her videos are screened nationally and internationally, and they include The Momentary Enemy, Blowback, Umbilical Cord, Asian Boys Nailed, and Balik Bayan, Return to Home. She is co-editor, along with Luis Francia, of the anthology Vestiges of War, The Philippine-American War, and the Aftermath of an Imperial Dream. Angel is currently an adjunct lecturer at Hunter College, teaching in the Asian American Studies program. She was a core faculty member in the Asian Pacific American Studies program at NYU, where she taught media, cultural, and community studies courses. She has also taught at Columbia University, the New School for Social Research, and the Pratt Institute. In 2009, she completed producing a series of cross-cultural exchange projects called Trade Routes, Converging Cultures, Southeast Asia, and Asian America. It consisted of artist residencies, artist talks, workshops, exhibitions, performance, and film screenings in Manila and three provincial cities in the Philippines with women artists from Indonesia, Singapore, the U.S., and the Philippines. Now you can tell us how to decolonize our minds and our culture. So let's give a warm welcome to Angel. Thank you.
Magandang umaga. Is that morning?
Yeah.
Okay. How to decolonize, stop speaking English. That's very hard for me to do. My Filipino's really bad. But I do think that the language is in my body somehow. And I think, or let's just say I hope that when you see the two earliest works of mine that that will come across, and we can talk a little bit about this notion of one's body being home, and it's not necessarily a nation or just a house or something. But first I just wanted to thank the Asian American Research Institute and Anthony Wong back there and Russell Leong again. Thank you so much for inviting me. This is actually really exciting for me because I haven't presented my works, these pieces especially, in a very long time where I've been around. And I love talking to audiences. Or let's just say I prefer if you all ask me questions instead, or you all talk to each other and me not just, okay? I don't want to say too much right now. The only thing that I will put in context is a little bit of the genesis, so of being an artist. You know, there's always that thing where people say, you know, I've been an artist ever since I can remember. You know, ever since I was 5 years old, I've always been drawing and this and that. And I think I fall into one of those stereotypical categories, but you know, you can ask my mom, she's sitting over there, and she'll tell you if that's true or not. But in terms of how I got to doing the kind of work that I'm doing, it really grew out of a frustration that I had of not being able to communicate with my painting. And it was really bothering me. It was very troublesome because I was also very socially, culturally aware of a number of things that were going on in our society and globally when I first got to art school. And photography, which I was also doing, wasn't doing the trick for me either. And I did a lot of bad writing. So I decided to merge them all and I think it was rather unconsciously, and started doing what I'm doing. Now, in terms of Philippine slash Philippine American slash just overall human being or female human, making the work that I've been doing, was really, really greatly influenced by absence and feeling like I needed to find where's the presence in this absence. Well, it was all around me in my family. And I just want to acknowledge them, I hope without embarrassing them. I really feel like, on one hand, I really need to acknowledge my mother, who really, in her own way, tried hard to impart things that were Filipino. And that's a hard thing to define. I think we're forever trying to figure out what is a Filipino, because we're always going to look for that. I think when you have, you know, what I consider to be a quadruply colonized identity, Filipino doesn't mean one thing. And I think my mother very successfully was able to teach me things about whatever it means. And my brother Noel, who I think from his studies at Berkeley, helped me a great deal to understand race and ethnicity. I didn't think about any of those things. I was one of those artists that really couldn't give, you know, right, this is being taped. You know, I just really didn't care about race and ethnicity. So anyway, this first piece called Balik Bayan, or Return to Home, I didn't know I was actually going to make a piece. This always happens to me. I didn't know I was going to do this, but I went to the Philippines after I graduated from art school, and I had a Super 8 camera, and so I just started documenting things. And Impressionism is a period of art that really influenced me a lot. So you'll see that the images are very pixelated, which is my homage to Impressionism. And then maybe if people have questions about that, I'll take them then, and then I can screen nailed. To say that I actually started this piece in 1985, which I think you hear at the very beginning. I was 21, got out of art school, didn't know, you know, what was I gonna do? Kind of a little bit like now, how many years later? No, I'm kidding. Questions, comments, thoughts? Yeah?
So you've done this for complete 4 months? You were there 4 months and did the filming 4 months?
Yeah, altogether I was there for 5.
Okay.
Yeah. Actually, during that time, I was taking a 16 millimeter editing course at the University of the Philippines. And my sound teacher, because this is right during the time in 85 when, you know, the snap election, you know, things were, the people's power thing was about to happen. And my teacher, you know, would take us all, she'd cancel class basically, and we would go to the rallies. And it just was major eye-opening experience. And a lot of the artists that I was meeting were social realist painters and a few filmmakers and people who were really involved in trying to use their art towards some form of social transformation. And I think very early on, seeing them and it kind of grows in you. I mean, it was like, because I'd been taking documentary type of photographs in the U.S. at rallies. The first one was when I was 13 at a No Nukes rally. So, but it wasn't like in the film, you see that I'd never, ever gone to anything like that. And the energy, if any of you have ever been to rallies in the Philippines, the heat and the energy, and you know, the anti-war rallies here, similar. But it's a different, also there's a certain kind of passion. And, you know, in hindsight, looking at this now as a much older person and stuff, I mean, You know, I perhaps would have shot it a lot differently, but it really was, the reason why it's so impressionistic is also because it's fleeting, and everything that I experienced in those 5 months on the outside were fleeting, but within me, I had no idea that that experience of being there in 1985 was going to really influence everything that I was to do and am going to do. So, yeah.
I think the film showed a really good contrast of how life is here in America versus how it is in the Philippines, but I think it was really interesting, like it gave a nice impression on how, even though it's a lot more poor in the Philippines, there's a lot more closeness between the families, and I think that documentary really, really showed that. I had a question. Where did you stay and live in those 4 months? Did you like live with those people, or did you have like a place?
I had gone to this landfill called Smoky Mountain, right, with these priests. So no, I didn't live in that area of Tondo. I stayed with my family who lived in Cubao. They live in Cubao, which is in Quezon City.
Okay.
Yeah, and then I, went to visit Baguio, which is where some of that other footage is from, where I stayed for a while as well. Yeah. Could you speak up, please?
Earlier you were talking about how your work around social and racial issues was prompted by absence. And I was wondering if you could talk more about what kind of absence you're referring to, is it something specific, what that means to you?
Well, it was actually through this piece, in terms of film, where I was beginning to see how I could use my creativity towards exploring what did I mean, what is this absence? But in a project that I did right before this, where it was my first book, which I self-published, called Silent Stories, was a book that grew out of an audio photographic installation that I made at the art school that I was at for my undergraduate show. And in the installation, I had photographed 18 Asian-born Asians, American-born Asians, and mixed-raced Asian Americans. And I didn't, in listening to their stories, I realized that we had a lot of things in common, which I didn't really know before. And so at that time, I realized that there was so much absence, that it was overwhelming. And I remember when I was first making the piece, before it became the book, I kept saying, oh, phew, I got the show up, and it's over, it's done, I'm over this identity crisis, and I'm me now, and all this kind of stuff. And I remember one of my mentors, said, oh, Angel, I'm sorry to tell you this, but it's just begun. And I thought, oh my God, what do you mean? And so I think on some level, I wasn't conscious yet that this work, I call it the Philippine series. So Balikbayan is the first, Nailed is the second, and then I go on from there. But I think that's where it came from, of beginning to understand. It's the absence of not knowing one's history, of not knowing things that, we blame ourselves, and we shouldn't. For those of you who teach, or for those of you that are students. Hi, Alice. she's one of my students now. And we talk about this, that, why do we blame ourselves for things we don't know about? It doesn't make any sense at all to blame yourself. We need to go out and ask questions. But how do you, sometimes it's scary to ask that question. So that's creating presence for this absence of knowledge, and what can knowledge give you? Right? And so even though maybe my pieces may not be traditional type of documentaries, I feel like and you all tell me that, you know, it's like a kind of challenge to get people to think more and create their own presence, basically. I know, it's very abstract.
I'm just curious why, like, you know, this film and then also Nailed, the narration was done by yourself, you know, it's your voice over. Does that have some significance, or would it be very different if you hire, like, an actor and then that person might read your script?
Yeah. Well, early influences are the three filmmakers that inspired me to stop painting and make film. One is a Vietnamese filmmaker, Trinh Tien Minh Ha, who you know, was doing a lot of work where she was really challenging what's called ethnographic filmmaking. And she basically got, you know, the anthropological, all the anthropologists freaking out, because she was doing things with the camera and, you know, using her voice and texts in a way that one would not think you should do in ethnographic filmmaking, because it's not the truth. There's something objective in it. And, you know, this notion of a documentary being objective is something that I don't believe in. I don't believe that there's any sense of objectivity. I think science can be objective, and even sometimes not when it's, you know, reported back to us. But so it's partially Minh Ha, who later became a mentor, the filmmaker Kedla Tahimik, who also does a lot of autobiographical type of film. He really influenced me, and also because he was a Filipino. And the third was a French filmmaker named Chris Marker, who, although he did not use personal voiceover, he influenced my style in a certain kind of way. And at CalArts at school, you know, that was like our time to like study feminist theory and all this kind of stuff. So I was like really into the personal as political. And the way I internalized whatever that may mean came into this decision to do the personal voiceover. And it's very sloppy. It's very, I mean, in Nailed, you'll hear it. I'm like stumbling over my words. And, you know, Kristen Lovejoy over here, who helped me, do you remember that? Like tape recording? And I'm like, blah, 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 you know, and she's, well, you'll hear it in a second. And also the editor of Nailed is back there too. Yay. Anyway, sorry. I hope I answered your question. Yeah.
I noticed that the music were by the Ifugaos, is that correct? I was wondering if you had any encounters with the tribal groups in the Philippines and what that experience was like.
Not during this time. In 88, 89, which you'll see in Nailed, I spent more time, and over subsequent years, I've been spending a lot more time, and I'm actually working on trying to develop a project right now, working with the ethnic indigenous artists from the north. So I'm not quite sure what the nature of your question is in terms of, you know, do I work with them in terms of composition? I'm like the people who the music, the gong music, is from the Ifugaos. Mm-hmm. And I think I just recorded it. They were doing a performance, and I was in Banaue, I think, and I recorded that. And then my friends, who I call the Baguio Boys, they're not indigenous ethnic Filipinos, but they live in Baguio, and they're great musicians. We can talk about the representation in Nailed if you'd like. Any other questions? Yeah?
First of all, I wanted to commend you of, like, in doing the whole of film, like, you being, like, you grew up here and, like, going back to your roots and actually trying to learn about what Filipino culture has got. But I guess my question is, like, at what point, because in your film you were highlighting how much different it is, like, growing up here and and then going back to the Philippines, and you see how much different the lifestyle is, and like a lot of poverty and, you know, like a lot of like strikes and stuff. I wanted to know, like, what was the turning point of your whole experience where you actually started to identify yourself, you know, to identify yourself with the culture, like, which, like, maybe you have, like, an experience wherein you actually told yourself, like, okay, I grew up differently, but, you know, like, in yourself, you know that you were Filipino, you know, like, it's, was there a turning point in your whole experience?
Not one singular one that I can give you, because there are different ways that you come to a consciousness about one's ethnic and national and racial identities, right? And, you know, when we were young, I was raised in an interracial family, and we grew up in the Bronx for 7 years and then moved out to a very white upper middle class suburban community, and there were like two Asian families or something there. And so I was really confronted with, you know, racial slurs and things like that, and feeling different. But I always thought my difference was not so much based on race, but was more because I was just weird, actually. I thought maybe I was just weird. And I thought everybody was like me, you know? Like, I didn't know that people didn't intermarry, you know? I was like, what's wrong with people? You know, I didn't, seriously. I mean, and I didn't think that we were weird, but people would come over and they'd see champoy and they'd, you know, bagong, you know, and they'd go, you know, what is that? And all that kind of stuff, right? And, but, so that kind of thing got pointed out by other people that you're different in terms of, so there's that consciousness already, and that difference is Filipino. Right, and then also because I'd been going back and forth to the Philippines since I was three, so I always had something in me, and this is what I meant when I said I butcher the Filipino language when I try to speak it, and it's extremely frustrating because they're beautiful languages, and I really am terrible at it. But I feel somehow like it's in me. I live it, and I can't explain it. And that's why I think it's very difficult for me to address your question in terms of one pivotal moment. But in terms of in the making of this piece, yes, you can see that I'm obviously, you know, looking for these quote-unquote roots, R-O-O-T-S. But what wound up happening is I went from those R-O-O-T-S to R-O-U-T-E-S. And I'm still kind of doing that thing. And there's forever a new consciousness. Because, like, you know, being Filipino is not one thing. I mean, if we went around the room and asked all the Filipinos in here what you think it is, you know, maybe you might have some common answers or, you know, moments of that recognition. I don't know. Yeah. Okay, will you?
You said, you know, the religion or the church gave, you know, somewhat of a different character to the Philippines.
You mean Catholicism? You know, I'm wondering if I can hold off on that question until screening Nailed, because Nailed really, really addresses where, like, full-blown, you know, head-on how I really feel that, you know, Catholicism, which was used by the Spaniards to colonize the Filipinos, and nobody likes to talk about religion. So I just, you know, I'd rather address that after screening that. Anything else? Okay, great. So Nailed. I started that in 1988. I didn't mean to make this piece. I was actually there writing my first feature narrative script, and this guy, I tend to do things, I was premature, so I think I have this terrible problem of getting ahead of myself, which can be really bad. And so, you know, I went over there and I shot 36 hours of footage because this guy that I thought was going to be my cinematographer asked me to, he'd never been to the Philippines, so he asked me to shoot all these things. And what I didn't realize was that what I was doing was basically shooting something, many stories that, again, were life-changing, life-altering. And when I got back from the Philippines, I was so alienated from being in the United States, being in New York, that I wanted to share these experiences with people. So I sat and I watched this footage, and this is what I came up with. Every time I look at this film, I feel like maybe I never gave up painting. I feel like, you know, there are over 560 edits in this piece, and I feel like they're brush strokes. I mean, I don't know if you guys can tell that I was kind of a possessed, obsessed person. Does that come across? Anyway, does anybody have any questions or comments? Yeah.
I enjoy watching these films because I think it's something I can relate to. And not just me, but like everybody can relate to trying to find yourself. But I think more specifically the fact that I've been living in America for practically my whole life, but every time I come to the Philippines, it's like what you said, like you can't really explain it, but like you said it before, like there's like a, like you know it's there. Like there's a void in your heart, but like it gets filled every time you go to the Philippines and see what it's like. And I appreciate you sharing these images with us because like it reminds me of some of the things I've seen over there. And like every time you come back to America, it's so easy to get engrossed in American life, but like your roots are still there, and you know it's still there, even though you may sometimes forget. And especially with the image of the woman getting nailed to the cross, like I've seen that a lot, like on TV in the Philippines, and you can see
really?
The difference.
Where?
Like on TV.
Women getting nailed to crosses.
Women, but like the news would like show like clips of things happening like that, and my family would always watch that. And it's interesting to see the reaction here because I saw a lot of people cringe and look away. Mm-hmm. Or for me, like it was nothing too out of the ordinary to see that. But yeah, thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
I was wondering, first of all, did she ever answer when you asked what does it feel like being a woman and being nailed to a cross? And second of all, why did you ask that?
I never asked her that. I asked myself that and said, I won't answer it. Yeah, sure.
I'm curious, do you know if Lucy continued doing that for a while?
She did. Let's see, that was 13 years. She stopped at 22 years. She basically said that she would continue doing this until the Santo Niño told her to stop. And I believe she still sells meat in the market. And I'm not sure if she's still faith healing, but she was every Tuesday. Mm-hmm. Yeah?
What did it feel like to be filming like these rituals? And did you feel like you were on the inside, like filming, or that it made you an outsider, or, yeah?
Actually, in all cases, I felt like an insider, and that would be because the pig sacrifice was actually a ritual for my goddaughter. You know, although I'd never been to one before, you know, I didn't feel uncomfortable. I thought my hair was on fire at one point, but it was the pig's hair, and I forgot that pigs had hair. So that was the only moment when I think I kind of freaked out. In terms of the other canyao, the wedding canyao, where you see the people dancing with the scarf, we were invited to someone's wedding, so I didn't feel like we were intruding on that wedding. So that felt pretty comfortable. And then in terms of Lucy, I mean, in my script, see, I'd heard that, you know, they had these crucifixions in the Philippines, and so in my script, I wanted a crucifixion scene, but a friend of mine told me that there was a woman who was doing this, and since my main character was a woman, I decided, I need to go find her, and it was an amazing journey all in of itself. We didn't know what village she was in exactly. And we went into the area of Paumbong in Bulacan, and this guy was walking down the street, and we asked him, "Do you know where Aling Lucy is?" And he said, "Oh, that's my sister." So he took us to her house, you know. And then some of my cousins came to help me translate, because also in Bulacan, the Tagalog is very deep. So I sat and they explained to her, or I spoke and then explained to Lucy what I was doing. And, you know, we talked for a little while and had an exchange. And then I went with her and on Holy Thursday. And they became like my little family for that moment, that those days that I was with them. And they really protected me. I mean, nobody was allowed to go into this little circle. I mean, I was balancing on a 2x4 beam and these men were holding my feet down. And I had a Super 8 camera. That's a regular video 8 camera, folks. For any of you that know video, it was a little box. Haha, and all these people with all these high-tech cameras, right? I mean, it was a little Nikon, it was great. And a regular still camera. And nobody else could be in there. So that's also why I could shoot the way I could. And the people were really amazing. I mean, her entourage, so the Centurions, took care of me. Because at the very end of it, I lost them, and I guess I fainted, and I passed out under a tree. And the next thing I know, I'm like lying on one of the Centurions' laps in the jeepney, you know, and they're like, you know, "Oh, we're going to Lucy's house now. We're going to have, you know, we're going to, you know," I don't know if you got there before I did, right? Yeah. Okay, so, you know, and I was really embarrassed, you know, because I had fainted. And, you know, Lucy's getting all cleaned up, like you see, and then she asked me if I wanted to stay and watch her play volleyball at 3 o'clock. You know, I was like, "No, I'm done. Thank you very much." But I'm now like really, something's going on in me. And I got really sick. I had a fever for a while and it was pretty intense. And that was another moment, I would have to say, when this notion, it's not even about being Filipino, it really is about something that's deeply human, more than anything else. It's not about a national identity. And there is something that Lucy gave to me that was very special and remains in me. You know, and I think, you know, at that point on some level, I don't feel like an outsider in the Philippines. But of course, in reality, in another way, other ways, I will be an outsider there, wherever I go, no matter what. Listen to my voice. Look at the way I carry myself. There are all kinds of things that will always make me an outsider and an insider. And that's what makes it fun and interesting, challenging. Yeah. Yeah, back there, and then you. Yeah,
I was really intrigued about the Atiatihan scene. Mm-hmm. And sort of this process of darkening your face. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the history of that and where that comes from.
I can tell you what I was told. Mm-hmm. When Miguel de Legazpi, and if anybody else knows this history, please jump in and or correct me. So my understanding is that when Miguel de Legazpi got, you know, on Panay and then Iloilo, the way that he was able to quote unquote lure, you know, the people was to put charcoal on their face, to darken their faces. And the Negritos, who are the aboriginal Filipinos that from that area, are darker skinned and curlier hair. And that's what I heard in terms of, I think it's that's more legend or myth or something. I mean, I don't know how true that is. But in that, during the Atiatihan, that was sort of like their way of expressing that. You know, and the thing that really struck me about the Atiatihan is that in that festival, you see everything from a resistance to colonialism and imperialism, and also this incredible embracing of it. You see, something that's very complex going on in that festival, which is one of the reasons why I enjoyed cutting it and the whole experience. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, I just would like to know that just by the film, it's the short film itself, is that you're showing both different sides of Catholicism, and then at the same time, there are other rituals that kind of like blend together.
Mm-hmm.
Because the christening that you showed was where they did some sort of the ritual,
right.
But then, they went to church to do the christening.
Right.
So there's always that part where we, like, for the hundred of years that they've been under the Spanish regime and being taught the Catholic way, but there will still be part of the Philippines, and the Filipinos have still that's deep in them, where
mm-hmm.
we have the rituals. It's still in them. And now my one question is, which I've been trying to like really see where, what's the man coming out from
yes,
because that was the one where I'm like really trying to figure out, it seems like it's like, you know, like God created man and that was it, and then at one point where he was having the ritual,
mm-hmm.
the thing, the repetitive stuff of him just stomping on the ground,
mm-hmm.
and then suddenly he goes to being, getting all of the idols and
mm-hmm. right,
Santonias and the Mother Mary, like they're all together. Like Mother Mary and the
right.
Santa Nina and everything else, they're all like different, but of the same.
Mm-hmm.
So can you kind of elaborate on that part?
I actually kind of want to throw it back to you, because it sounds to me like you understand, you got it. You know, I mean, it's your interpretation as much as it is mine. So, I mean, I can certainly share with you more about that, but I don't mean to be obnoxious. I mean, I'd gladly answer your question, but I just kind of like the fact that you're right there with it. You know, I mean, basically, he is like, man,
yes.
And he's also Lazarus. You know, and he represents. So that section is ritual or blind faith.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, in many ways, he represents the everyday man. And the transformation of him, and you know, and then Beast of Burden. So that's why I intercut him with the Carabao. Sure. May you?
Oh.
I wanted to go back to your Catholicism.
Right. One of the things that is, I think, have always astounded me in terms of being in the Philippines, being Filipino, participating in some of this, having witnessed it, right, is how comfortable the fluidity of being is. Because as serious as the theme is, whether it be in All Souls Day, it was also like a fiesta,
mm-hmm.
right? But there seems to be less conflict about this fluidity of the animal sacrifices,
mm-hmm.
right? And stepping into church, right? With the least bit of trouble. And I was, you know, thinking about that in terms of your first film of the other, right? The recognition of the other and
mm-hmm.
what that is like for the Filipinos, right? With all this colonial.
Right.
But we experience it even now, you know, how astounding it is that it is with little conflict. People participate in this and with such fluidity of being whatever it is called for at the moment, both ritualistic and spontaneous. So you know, one would think, you know, these animal sacrifices on that same day that one is being baptized, you know, these things.
It's coexistence.
It's cold and very comfortably, you know, people move in and out of that being right by the, you know, sacrifice. And
yeah, I mean, I think on you know, one on one very real level, it is to, you know, try to talk about a certain kind of continuum. There are so many layers to Nailed, and why the sections. I mean, everything, you know, it took me 3 years to edit this thing. I was really like an obsessed, you know, my poor mother had to listen to Hail Mary, Full of Grace a million times because I'm editing in my bedroom, you know, it's like Hail Mary, you know, whatever. But I mean, on one level, I think, because there was one, I don't know, it was actually on CUNY TV, and the guy asked me, why is Nailed so violent? And I said, well, I don't think Nailed is violent. And he said, it's terribly violent. And I said, well, colonization is violent. And then he couldn't answer after that. And I do find it interesting that it's more difficult to watch this woman who's been doing this for years and says that this is, you know, she's perfectly okay with this, that it's okay, you know, so it's harder for an audience to watch a woman being nailed to a cross. I mean, and it's easier to watch, but yet somehow not, a pig being sacrificed. And part of what I was after, outside of like showing this duality, right, and cross-cutting with the baptism and this kind of stuff, the two sides of how one is officially brought into a religion or the world, right, society, was to show exactly this violence, or what, not violence, but how to question that. What is it? You know, and not, again, not to answer it, but to question, to raise that question.
But your note about it being a sacrifice is noteworthy. The context is obviously very different of Lucy being so much part of this versus the pig. But
well, we all ate them after that. I mean, like, I've never had a pig cooked in so many different ways in my life. It was an extraordinary meal that lasted for like 8 hours or something. I mean, it was just amazing. And my goddaughter, the reason why they also, not everybody does, you know, doing a canyao is expensive. It's not cheap. It costs a community, you know, I don't know what it costs today, but back then it was 3,000 pesos per pig. And, you know, that actually, that one might have cost a little bit more because it was a decent sized pig. And, you know, and it's, they do it for birth, death, marriage. And you know, some people will, they mostly do it with chickens, but some people will do it like if they want to get the reading of, if they're opening a restaurant or something. But this, I'm talking about within the northern part of the Philippines, right? And it is a very interesting, you know, kind of sharing, because the whole community shares in a very different way than you'll see like in church. People aren't necessarily sharing in church. And so that was a whole other thing, kind of thing that I wanted to try to point out in terms of indigeneity and also the way that, while at the same time Catholicism or Spanish Catholicism has become its own, now it's, what would the word be, Filipinoized? A Filipinoized Catholicism. It's different. Like Mexican Catholicism is different from Italian Catholicism or Spanish Catholicism, or, you know. So, Russell, how are we doing on time? Are we over? Are there any other comments, questions? Yeah.
I think just one last thing that I thought was very, like, interesting and funny in a way is that when it's Filipinos that are watching Nailed, they wouldn't see. I mean, it's kind of like more. It's not as violent to look at if you're a Filipino and you're like seeing the pig being sacrificed. Also because we're. Well, Filipinos love to eat pork and like. Dish, they would eat pork, and somehow, like seeing the pig, you know, like get sacrificed. But then after that, you know that you're gonna eat it. Like somehow it makes it like normal. It's like Filipino, you know. It's like part of your culture. Like it's mm-hmm. what you eat, and it's just like the life cycle of like how
yeah.
the pigs.
And look, you're celebrating somebody's life. I mean, my I forgot to mention the very specific thing that my goddaughter actually, the actual ritual was done because she was adopted and her mother had tried to abort her, and she survived. And my friend and his wife had adopted her. And so it was very important, the parents thought, to do this kind of ritual because they were also very respectful, and in fact in many ways were embracing the indigenous, because the Ibaloy are the ones who live in that area, but I think the Mambaki, the priest who was the one who was chanting, I think he came from Bontoc, which is a whole nother group. Indigenous ethnic group. But anyway, I mean, you know, it was a very important thing symbolically and spiritually.
Yeah. And if you think about it, it could be more violent, like having pigs killed, like uncelebratory. You know what I'm saying? Like on a regular basis and not even acknowledging how they're going to, you know, like it's
celebration. Slaughtering that sacrifice.
I'm sorry, what?
Slaughtered.
Yeah.
Angel, have you shown this film in the Philippines for a similar?
Oh, yeah.
Is the audience response somewhat different from the showing it here in the States?
It's, well, I haven't been to a lot of the screenings. I mean, it's actually Nailed has screened in a lot of really wonderful places over the last 21 years since I first made it. The last screening I had was in 2012 in Dumaguete at Silliman University. And I have to tell you, I mean, personally, from being with these young 17 to 19 or 20 year olds and them, you know, seeing this, not knowing that at that time it was a 20 year old piece, was a beautiful experience for me. And then to have this incredible dialogue with these young people, was extremely valuable and enriching, and every dialogue that I've had, not just in the Philippines, but you know, in other places as well, you know, they have been very rich. A lot of them, and some of them, some people have gotten angry, you know, which I can understand, and very upset. Some people have wept, and they feel very bodily kinds of things going on. Some people get really angry. And mixed emotions. The state of things, the way Catholicism, you know, depending on how you're coming to this piece, right? So let's say, like, so for instance, this one young man who was a really devout Catholic, this guy who in Dumaguete recently, last year, had said that he was angry, and I asked him, what do you mean angry? And he said he felt like he was ashamed of himself for being Catholic. And so we had this whole conversation about this, and you know, also what responsibility do I have as the filmmaker, you know, and how far does that responsibility go? Because at the same time, you know, the fact that this young man got angry, I'm like, yahoo. But you know, but on the other hand too, you know, it can't just be that that yahoo, right? I mean, so that's why I felt really glad that I had the opportunity to talk to him, and he could talk to his peers and his teacher, and we could all discuss his anger. In other audiences, I've experienced Filipinos who get angry because they feel like I'm representing the country in a bad way and I should be excommunicated and blah, 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 blah. And this one time that that happened, I asked the man, why did you stay if this film upset you so much? I said, there's something about it that actually I think got to you. And he got really mad and he just and left. And I was like, well, you stayed. You didn't have to stay. He could have walked out. Anyway, last one, yeah.
Just to get back to the juxtaposition of the Catholicism and the animalism.
Animism.
Yeah, the animism in the film. I wonder when you were in the Philippines and you were first exposed to this flavor of Catholicism, what was your reaction to this from an intellectual and a spiritual level? Coming from your background as I think you said in one of the films, you never went to church, but I guess you were exposed to it, but it was, again, a different flavor of Catholicism, and then you come to the Philippines and you see this brand of Catholicism.
Yeah. Well, keeping in mind that I'd been going back and forth to the Philippines a lot and seeing this, you know, that kind of Catholicism everywhere, and very, you know, really early on, forever, and maybe it's because my father died when I was a baby, that I always questioned God, you know? Who was this, what was this thing that took my father away? So, you know, I think God for me was something that, you know, I think like for many people, it's just so, whoa, you know, don't just, you know, don't go there or whatever. Now, God in relationship to Catholicism and the way that I saw, the way that Catholicism was being practiced. I mean, I started reading a ton of books, and I always loved the Old Testament, and you know, wasn't such a huge fan of the New Testament. But you know, and I just was fascinated because I was really trying to understand these contradictions. And intellectually speaking, I didn't know what post-colonialism was. It wasn't until I went to graduate school that I went, oh my God, nailed as a post-colonial piece, you know? But I mean, you know, it wasn't like I'm walking around going, oh wow, I'm making a post-colonial piece, you know? And I'm, you know, I knew that I was wanting to make a piece that was commenting on the effects of colonialism and how religion, Catholicism, was being used. And I was afraid. I have to tell you, I mean, the other reason why it took 3 years to make this piece was because it was scary. You know, I did think about what was my family in the Philippines going to think. I was terrified of them seeing this. I had become friends with Cardinal Sin. I was terrified that he would hate this film, you know. I never let him see it, or at least I don't think he did see it. But I mean, you know, so there's that kind of thing. I'm sorry, these lights are kind of spacing me out. Could you ask me the second part of the question again?
Well, I just want to get a feeling of how when you got exposed to that originally, how that you processed that, given your prior background in Catholicism. Did you say, oh, well, you know, this is, you know, kind of neat. This is, you know, another branch, or you thought to yourself, again, on an intellectual level, ooh, I mean, This is you know, the culture layering the, you know, old ancient traditions on, you know, with the Catholicism, you know, on one level, but then on a spiritual level, did you say, oh, that's very attractive, and I, you know, I can embrace that. I mean, I on a spiritual level, I not just get it up here, but get it
right
here, and then and say, oh, well, that's the flavor for me.
Yeah.
Or, on the other hand, well, you know, maybe that's not my cup of tea.
Well, on a spiritual level, I would say that absolutely. In Balikpayan, I said that I had no, my poverty lied in the fact that I didn't have a spirit. I didn't have a sense of, you know, and I don't want to idolize or romanticize the struggles of Filipino people in the Philippines and the lack thereof of some of the Filipinos there, or what seems to be no struggles for them too. I think everybody has struggles on whatever levels, and that, what happened to me was on this trip, this year of being there, was finding or embracing spirituality in a way that has had such a profound impact on me that I think it's very dangerous to even try to talk about, and that there's certain things that I just sort of, I feel like faith and what you believe in is really personal. And you can go to church and you can be, as we all know, the biggest sinner on the planet, you know, whatever. I think that in theory, what I really wanted, what I'd love to see, is people embracing the Lucy in themselves. So for me, the embracing of the Lucy in me is really about embracing what I see as acts of resistance. Now, if what Lucy does, which is, people can, they criticize her all the time, or they did, and thought she was, some people thought she was nuts, some, you know, whatever. Some people thought she just did it for spectacle. There were a whole bunch of different things of what people were saying. And what I got from Lucy was something that's, I guess, yeah, it gives you hope. I mean, you know, it's an extraordinary thing when you really do touch this person's hands, and even just to allow people to do that to you. You put the nail the wrong way, you're going to shatter every bone in your hand, you know? And that kind of trust, the very first time, those two twins, they were twins who did this, and they had a calling like everybody there. They all, like, those guys came from the Visayas, somewhere in the Visayas, and, you know, you have to know what you're doing. And the amount of trust that she had to be able to do that is really something. And she doesn't, as you can see, she no longer at that point gets nailed all the way through her hands and feet. So I felt like deeply that if people could understand that how Lucy symbolically is sacrificing herself on some level, and what people, you know, how people survive, I just sort of saw that as acts of resistance. And same thing with the way people embrace animism. It's there, it's always there. I'm not sure if that totally answers your question, but I think it's time to let these guys wrap up. So I want to thank you all very much for coming.